Okay. Well, welcome all again for the second lecture of software security. Last week it got to our attention, it got to our attention that the program that we had originally thought of might not suit all of you equally well, because there might be some differences in background. So we really sat down to see if we can adjust it a bit so that it is interesting for all of you. So this is why we came up with three different routes of going through this course, and you can pick any of the three, but you have to pick at least one. You can do all three if you like, but that's a lot of work. But you have to pick at least one for your grade. The theory exam will be the same for all of you, which is mainly chapter 10, 11, and 5 of the book, mainly. And some additional keywords, but I will put keyword lists on the site for you to go through, and that will be the so the theory exam is the same. The only difference is the assignments, the labs, because some students have, for example, a programming background, and they might want to really look into how do I do safe coding, which is nice. And also, if you have interest in it, then this is a nice track. But it will have to it does imply that you do have to do a lot of coding, of course, programming. Or maybe you are good with system administrating, and you're more interested in penetration testing of software. We made a track for that as well. But that means you need to have, I mean, it's going to involve a lot of low-level system things. So if you're not really into systems, then maybe that's not your thing. And then the last, the last one that in the line that I'm now lining up, is the audit track, and that's for if you're not particularly interested in the technical details of programming or technical details of pen testing, but more in from a business perspective or a management perspective, or how do I have to deal with software issues, with software security issues. So we came up with these three tracks. The first track we called the audit track. For auditing, for those who don't know, auditing is big business. All three of them are big business, but this is auditing is big business. Auditing is typically done by large accounting firms like KPMG or Deloitte, and organizations ask them to audit their systems and their security. I know some people at KPMG who do security auditing, and they make good money. You can make a lot of money in this field. Of course, this course, this 7-week course, is not going to make you a full auditor enough to make a lot of money. But it's a step. It's a first step. Huh? And the focus of this track is towards that kind of a position. And it involves mainly the writing of three papers on PHP and Java. I think this is in the world of, and this is for those who are not really into programming. PHP and Java are big in web development. Both Java is used a lot for server-side interactive websites, and so is PHP. And in the field of IT, in this field of web development, there's kind of a flame war going on between the two. Which one is better? PHP is better, Java is better. Well, I don't know. I genuinely don't know. I have my suspicions, but I don't know. Yes?
If you get this track, is it allowed to have paper on ASP.NET
as well? ASP.NET instead of Java.
PHP and Java.
PHP and Java. And .NET or?
Yeah, maybe.
To edit, of course. Sure. Yeah, I would definitely like to keep PHP in there. So if you want to, I am okay with exchanging Java for .NET because it's similar. Although I think this is easier because I think, well, it's interesting. Yeah. But this is something you can also discuss with Arjen, because he's good with this. Then the next paper is on the severity of cross-site scripting, and we will see what it is. And SQL injection. SQL injection, both SQL injection and cross-site scripting are currently big in the field of hacking and getting into systems. We know that Sony, for example, was hacked using SQL injection. But for example, others have been hacked using cross-site scripting. They're both very nice tools to do hacking. And the question is, in this paper, which one is worse? Which one is a bigger threat? Which is typically, if you place yourself in the role of an auditor, these are the kind of questions that people will ask you. In business, people will ask you, hey, we need to develop a new system. Can we use PHP? Or is Java okay? Which one should we use? We need to protect ourselves. What protection is more important? SQL injection or cross-site scripting? And the last one is a small one. The last one is on code signing. Code signing is it's not new, but it's becoming the standard. If you don't sign your code, it typically won't work anymore on the system. Signing is we will look into that. It's the last lecture we will do, but code signing is more or less placing an identity on your code, saying that this code was made by me. And there's a price we pay for this. And this is quite there's quite a lot of freedom that we lose because of it. And this is also a typical question for an auditor. Should we have a code signing infrastructure, like a system which uses an infrastructure which uses code signing, or not? Because it implies quite a lot. Okay, so this is track one, and track one does do two labs: a lab on assembly coding, because it's necessary to understand. I think it's 10.1, chapter 10. Paragraph 1 is on buffer overflows, which is important for the theoretical exam. And in order to understand that paragraph, you need to know a little bit about assembly coding, and you need to know a little bit about the workings of the stack. So there's two labs on that, but they're not. They're minimal, technically the minimum we should do in order for you to understand the chapter. Okay, then the next track. The next track is more from the perspective of the software programmer. Yeah, I see people, oh, I'm going to do that one. Maybe, I don't know. As a programmer, you want to protect yourself against these attacks. And there are tricks, bless you, there are tricks to defend yourself against these attacks. And if you want to know more about how that is done, and you want to play with that, then there's labs and assignments on programming, mostly programming. This is all about programming. So again, the same lab on, well, the same, it's a slightly altered lab of assembly programming. And because assembly programming is, it's necessary, again, for chapter 10, paragraph 1, you need to understand the workings of mainly function calls, how that works on the stack. Because that's how most attacks work. Hey, welcome. We just started, like 5 minutes ago, so you're perfect on time. I was just explaining the three tracks. Then the lab on a lab on Python, Ruby, and C++ coding, an assignment on Java and JavaScript coding to get you warmed up to stretch your muscles for coding, because we want to get everyone up to speed in this track on programming languages. It's not about the programming languages, but we want to show you in these programming languages how to protect yourself from, for example, buffer overflows, injection, buffer underruns, that kind of stuff. So, and because we will be using these languages, you have to show or at least practice a little bit in how these languages work. Then, we have a lab on defensive coding against cross-site scripting. How that is, so we have some defensive coding there to protect yourself. A lab on defensive coding against SQL injection and buffer overflows, which are the, then we have the big ones covered. And we try to look at as many examples as we can in as many of these programming languages. And a final lab on rootkits. And that's just a closing lab. It's more for fun to show you how a rootkit is, what a rootkit is, and how it works, and how you program a rootkit. So if you're into it, rootkits are nice to play with, huh? The last track in this list is if you're more interested in systems and pen testing. Again, I have to warn you, for all these tracks, it's a specific profile, and you should see if you match the profile, because each track is a lot of work, but if it fits with your profile, it should be okay. I mean, because the reason we created these tracks is because we wanted to challenge each and every one of you in your own field, whatever you feel comfortable with. So here, the profile here is that you are a system administrator, system operator, or owner of system, and you want to make sure that your system is safe, and you want to do testing. Is my system safe? That kind of stuff, technical. So the first one is more managerial, business, and the last two are more technical. From a programmer's perspective, where you have to do a lot of programming, and from in this case, systems. So again, the same lab on assembly coding, or yet again a little bit different lab, but it's all about assembly coding. With the same reasoning, we need to know how the stack works mainly. Then an assignment on Linux system calls and interrupt service routines. Lab on DLL kernel modules and dynamically linked modules in Linux. The SO is a DLL for Linux. Linux also uses, or Linux and Unix also use DLLs, but they're called SO. You load them dynamically. Then a lab on C++ coding to because we need that for to see what happens later on. An assignment on Java, mainly because it's important for the technical guys to understand object-oriented programming. We need to understand how that works, how that architecture is. And this is why there's an assignment to play a little bit with object-oriented programming. Then, so this is all about building knowledge on your system, and then here, and architectures, and here we start playing with it. Our lab on penetration testing of buffer overflows, a lab on pen testing cross-site scripting, and a lab on pen testing SQL injection. And same as the other technical track, a lab on rootkits, but that's just the cream on the cake, or is it the icing on the cake? I don't know. So in short, we have three tracks. We still might make small changes to the tracks as we come along, because we also learn from we learn with you as we go through the tracks. Maybe we should adjust them slightly. But this is the layout of the three tracks. You need to choose at least one, and but you can you are allowed to do as much as you. I mean, everything is open. You can do everything you want, but you have to do at least one. The theoretical exam is the same for all of you, mostly about the chapters 10, 11, and 5 of the book, and the practical stuff, that's where it differs. So, and the this is the profile of the auditor, the administrative auditor, is our who answers questions to management on the status of the IT systems. Are they safe? What is safe? Managerial questions. Should we use PHP? Should we use Java? Is it okay to use PHP? That's what an auditor. How safe is PHP? How safe is or how bad is cross-site scripting? This is for the if you have a more programmer kind of profile and would like to learn about how do I create safe code. And this is more if you have a system administrating profile and you want to see if your system is safe, if there's any leaks in your system.
I have a question about the amount of work, because
yeah.
First track it's only 5 assignments, here I can see like
we had a very close look at it, and we think it's all about the same, depending on your profile. So we expect that this is the assumptions we make to keep it interesting for all of us. The assumption we made here is that you are reasonably well at writing in an administrative style, that you're reasonably good at writing. But to create a paper is a lot of work. So this is why there's not many labs here, because writing a paper is it will take the time. If you want to do a good paper, it will take time. Here we assume that you are a programmer, or that you like programming. And if you are a programmer, even if you're only a programmer in one language, it shouldn't be too much of a hassle to learn Python, Ruby, see, because we don't expect you to be ace programmers in these languages. We just want you to see that how these languages work. So if you are a programmer, if you feel confident programming, then the first two labs and the first two labs and assignment shouldn't be too much work, because I mean, if you program, you can do that with your eyes closed. You you take a few soda drinks and done. So where it gets difficult is here. So this is like the papers. In the first one, we have it here. And this is only to warm up the muscles. That's the idea. If you're not a good programmer, this will be tough. But it's the same thing here. Here the assumption is that you know a little bit about system administration. So you should here assume that you know a little bit on how Linux works, the inner working of Linux, what a DLL is, what a module is, what the kernel is, and what a system call is. So same here, these first labs, the assembly coding, assignment on Linux, lab on DLL, lab on C++ should be fairly quick. I mean, if you've some experience with system administration, that should be okay. You should be quick with that. So then here it starts getting difficult. So these are the assignment on Java is probably because we want to look at object-oriented programming, pen testing, buffer overflows, pen testing XSS, and SQL. So then these four, that's where the bulk of the weight is, so to say. The lab on rootkits is just for fun, more or less. It's put in there to mainly for fun. Same here. Lab on rootkits is for fun. Although for system administrators, the lab on rootkits should be a little bit easier because they understand the concept of the system, and probably for programmers because rootkits are very low in the system, it's a little bit more work. So that's the idea. But we think we did the math, and it should balance out. Yeah, if it matches your profile, this should be challenging for all of you in at least one of the three. Yeah. Yeah. If you know how it works, XSS and SQL injection. Which one? Which track?
The second track.
Coding. Yeah. Then it should be. It shouldn't be too difficult. Yeah. Well, I mean, this should not be too difficult if you know how to program. This should not be difficult. This is probably the most challenging one of the three, but we want to have it challenging for everyone, huh? So, yeah. I have another. I was asked by Reza for another call. For last week, I said that we have this capture the flag project available. And we would like to. Who wanted to do that? Who wanted to join in the Capture the Flag project? See, 1, 2, 3, 4.
Question.
Yeah. Mostly in Amsterdam. Yeah. If not, it's in Hilversum.
Okay.
It's or we have a location here in Amsterdam. The port, and one in Hilversum. But and we can maybe make some sort of a change or something. We can work on that. Those that just raised their hands, maybe you can give your name to Arjen, so he can make a list. Then, if you could do that, then.
They sent already an email, didn't they?
Yes, we did.
Who did not send an email?
Who did not?
I sent one.
Oh, can you send it to Arjen as well? So if everyone who wants to join in on the project, then please email Arjen, and he will make a list. And we can. It's only 5 times or so. I think 5 times. A few hours that you need to go to either the port. Amsterdam support, or to Hilversum, yeah. So it's that's it. It's not that you have to go all the time to I don't know. I'm a sword Apeldoorn. Okay. Yeah, that's it. So well, no, I mean not that's all of it, but I mean that's the three tracks. So we will. I think we will try to get something on VLO so that you can announce which track you would like to do, so that we know of each of every one of you who does what, and we will upload the details as soon as we can this week, because we have to work this out. We try to make it keep it interesting for all of you. That's why we changed it. Okay, let's have a look at the under the hood. And for those, now this lecture is about the assembly language platform of the computer. And another thing which we will change is how to arrange the lectures and the workshops and Thursday. We got a lot of questions on, do we really have to be there on Thursday? Well, we will make a schedule, because now we have three tracks. We will make a schedule of who needs to be where and when Arjen is available, when I'm available, how we will do that. And for now, let me talk with Arjen for 1 minute. Misschien kun jij gewoon apart gaan zitten nu al met degene die gewoon die assembly lab willen gaan doen.
Die dit al kennen?
Die dit al kennen, ja.
En dan van, maakt niet uit welke track?
Nee, want dat we gewoon de assembly. Alleen de BIM-groep moet gewoon blijven zitten.
Maar die, en die kiezen waarschijnlijk.
Of moeten die ook, die hoeven de assembly lab niet te doen? Die moeten na gaan denken over PNP.
Want dit is natuurlijk wat je nu gaat vertellen, dat is voor onze SNE-student allemaal bekend. Hè?
Ja, die zitten er voor spek en bonen. Ja. Ja.
Dus misschien maar heel kort even, moeten we even vragen wie wat wil doen? Dat is misschien eerst, dat even handig.
Oh ja, ja, dat is goed. Ja.
Oké, dat kunnen we op zich, maar hebben we een lokaal? Waar gaan we zitten?
Kan ik, oh, als jij even kijkt wie er in welk track zit, dan ga ik even snel een lokaal regelen nu. En dat moet in het Engels. Dit is
de camera. Audio. Oké. So for us it's important at this moment to organize things quite well, at least we try to do, that we know who wants to follow what track. So is it clear for you what we meant with those tracks? Yes, and did you make up your mind already? Because who would like to join the first track? Can you please raise your hand? Nobody here likes writing, okay. And the second one? So it's about software development. Okay, so 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, about 15, okay. And the rest, that's also about, so the rest, the pen testing?
Yep.
If you raise?
Yeah.
About, also about. Okay, and is there anyone here who wants to join both? About? Let's say, so you have a lot of work to do, huh? The exam in the end will be the same, but there's a lot of work to do then. So we have about 10, let's say about 10 who wants to do both. Tracks, the second and third. We have none who wants to do the first track.
Oh, that's good.
So you succeeded in our
yes.
In our
no.
interesting. Sicker. And both. Okay. I think. So today is mostly about the computer architecture, isn't it?
Yeah, right?
Yeah, so today the course is, the presentation is mostly about computer architecture, assembly language, how to program CPU, the ISA, things like that. Huh?
Yeah.
Okay, so I know there are here a lot of students who are already familiar with that. So we can imagine that's no fun for them to stay here. So what we propose is that we can already start with the first lab, in fact of both tracks. We have just made a reservation for a room. So for those, how many would like to follow the presentation about computer architecture? So that's about?
The presentation is about assembly language programming, stacks, that kind of stuff.
Okay. So, what we suggest is that we, within 15 minutes then?
No.
No?
Yeah. So that we go to F104. So we have made a reservation for that room, and we can start then with the assembly language lab. Yeah? Yeah?
So for those who are not interested in the presentation about assembly language programming, they can follow Arjen to room F104 to start working on the assembly lab. That are both tracks have an assembly lab. They are different. The assignments are different for both labs. Yeah. So if you want to do both tracks,
you have to do both.
You have to do both assignments. And for those who want a presentation first, then they stay here, and I will give a presentation on assembly labs. You are first.
Yeah, thank you. What about the lab second about Kali Linux you got last week?
Yeah.
It was uploaded. Do we still need to do it?
It's a lot of fun.
Yeah, exactly.
I mean, the first two labs, you don't have to hand in, but it's to get ready, and it's a lot of fun.
Yeah,
because
exactly.
It shows you how easy it is to work. Okay. So yeah, I'd recommend it, but you don't have to hand it in. Yes.
Yeah. How relevant is
this one? No, no, because it's all old stuff.
Yeah. For you, it's old stuff. Yeah.
Any other questions? For now? Sorry. How are they?
Okay.
F104. En dan straks nog wel even een schemaatje. Voor wat, wanneer?
Ja, ik ga even ook iedereen langs. Misschien moet ik even een Google Drive spreadsheet maken van welke student wat doet. Hè?
Oh ja, dat is wel handig. Ja.
Hebben we een lijst van op VLO natuurlijk? Kunnen we een lijst uit?
Ja, van VLO hebben we een lijst. Dus die kunnen we uitdraaien. Ja.
Okay. Ik heb gewoon een vraag. Ik wil eigenlijk zoveel mogelijk programmeren. Dat echt een zwakke kant is.
Ja.
Maar.
Nou, richt je voornamelijk op 2, zou ik inderdaad zeggen.
Ja,
en je doet ook mee met 3.
Ja, precies. Okay.
Ja, het is wat meer werk voor jullie, maar jullie hebben tijd genoeg.
Ja,
een dag in 24 uur.
Ja.
7 in de week.
Je weet niet wat tijd voor project hebben.
7 in de week. Nou ja.
We zitten al over ons projectuur heen. Dus voor 2 semester.
Slaap jij nog?
Ja, in principe 2, zeg je. En dan
zou lekker proberen. Ja, natuurlijk.
Ja, is leuk. Het is echt niet onmoeilijk.
Want het is leuk.
Nee, maar ik wil zoveel mogelijk.
Dat je de combinatie van beide ziet. Hè? Want aan de ene kant zie je dan hoe je bijvoorbeeld SQL injection met de manier van programmeren. Aan de andere kant zie je hoe je het kan.
Kijk.
Dus 2 maar dan wel gewoon eentje kiezen om uit
te. Je moet er één kiezen. Je moet er verplicht. Kiezen. Want je moet namelijk van die ene moet je de opdracht inleveren. Dus je kiest er een en van die ene moet je de opdracht.
Ik wacht graag aan de bak. Ja, dan. Oké. Nou, succes Arjen. Leuk. Ze staan klaar, hè, de labs. Oké, so this is the group for the presentation. We will have a look at the lower level, how a computer works, and mainly assemblage language programming, the stack. Let me get something to write with. And I understood that all of you will do either track 2 or 3, or maybe even both tracks 2 and 3. So all of you will do the assembly language programming lab. Nice. It's good. But, a CPU. We saw this picture yesterday already, or last week already. A CPU is basically, it has registers, which is memory. And these registers, they all contain just one number. There's not several, one number, that's it. And it's not that many. If we look at the Intel architecture, the i7, which is one of the latest processors, these are all the registers in there. No more, no less. This is it. So It's not that many. And what we can do with these numbers is we can feed them into the arithmetic logical unit. That's a piece of logic hardware somewhere here. I assume, if we look here, I assume it's this thing over here. I'm not sure, but it's what I assume. Yeah, I think. Because these look like the registers. And because there's most connections moving this way, so this if you look at that schematics over there, it makes sense. On top there you see it's a four quad core processor. So there's four full processing units, cores or processors are there, copy pasted next to each other. That's this one, just copy pasted. That's it. Okay. Let's see. Then we will have a quick in the lab. We will look at the i386, which is the first Intel processor, the first 32-bit Intel processor, which was mature. All the processors before, it started with the 4004 and the 8008 and the 8080 and the 8086 and 8088. And these processors were good, but they were very simple. Too simple to create the advanced operating systems which we use nowadays, like Windows, Linux, Unix, OS X from Mac. They would not be able to run on any of these processors. The first processor which was capable of running that type of operating system was this one. And the difference between this one and the previous ones is the capability of virtual memory and privileged instructions. Do you still remember what privileged instructions were from last week? Privileged instructions that not everyone was allowed to do, because what type of instructions were? First of all, who is allowed to do more instructions than anyone else on the system? The kernel, yeah. The kernel is the core of the operating system, and it is allowed to do more than the others. And what more? Everything, yeah, but what is the kernel allowed to do, what the others are not allowed to do? System calls, yeah. Well, I mean the execution of system calls, but what is a system call? What do they do?
Address memory.
Yeah, the virtual memory management, I/O, putting something on the disk, taking something from the disk, that kind of stuff. It's all restricted only to the kernel. And you already point out a very interesting thing, the so-called kernel call, of system call. And the system call is, if I'm not the kernel, so I'm another program, la 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 la, I'm Word, I am Word, la la la, and now Word wants to read something from the disk. Now I have a problem. Houston, I have a problem, because I am not allowed to read anything from the disk. So I have to ask the kernel to do that for me. And how do I ask the kernel to do that for me? Using a system call. And a system call is at a very low level, is we call the kernel and say, please read disk from disk for me. Yeah, perfect. Why did we choose the 386 for the lab? Because it's the most simple architecture that is capable of the advanced operating systems. If you go any, if you take any processor below this, it's not a real representation of the system that we use today. But if you go higher up, they get more advanced and more complex. So that's why we chose this for the lab. There is, however, a catch, especially for those doing track 3, because they will program an interrupt service routine And then you need to really dig in some software. You really need to create a good piece of software. And if your system is a 64-bit system, the lab is a 32-bit lab. And that is not compatible with each other. So you will have to look into the differences between 32-bit programming and 64-bit programming. There's a different instruction set. The 32-bit instruction set is different than the 64-bit instruction set. And the lab is using the 32-bit instruction set. It's not completely different, but it's different enough that the 32-bit program will not work together with a 64-bit program. So if you take examples from the internet, if there are 32-bit programs from the internet, you have to compile them as 32-bit programs, but that might be a huge challenge, as I found out myself as well, on a 64-bit computer. So this is something you will, and especially track 3 has to worry about this. Track 2, not so much, because they can play around enough with the 32-bit coding. Track 3, they will probably run into this problem. So you'll have to look into it. Okay, here we see the example from the lab. This is assembly code, what we call assembly code. At the lowest level, computer code is just bits. Nothing more, nothing less. Bits. So if you look at, I don't know if you've ever seen a memory dump, but it's all the hexadecimal represent, all these bits that look like this, huh? 6A71800AB D4C7. Code like that. That's a memory dump. And this is what type of numbers are these? Hexadecimal numbers. Yeah. And they represent bits. So 6A represents 0110 1010. 71 represents 0111 0001. Huh? And so on. So this is just a series of bits. That's it. And that's machine code there. And in the lab you will see machine code. You will look at the machine code created for this example program. But for us to program machine code, not easy. I have done it myself because when I did my when I studied myself, we still had very old computers at our school, of course, and they had to be booted with machine code. So you actually had to do this yourself. But nowadays, it's not often that you play around with machine code. Of course, if you want to analyze malware or something which went wrong with your code, or a security breach, then sometimes you have to dig all the way down to this level to actually see what's going on, to see what happens at this level. This is called machine code. This is for us difficult to write. So what they did is they created a language which we can understand, but basically what we see here is machine code. So there is an instruction for the CPU, and maybe the instruction is let's just live have a look. 386 instructions set reference. Here. Ta-da! So here we see these are the instructions we can do This is the whole Intel range of processors is downwards compatible, which means that all the instructions of the older models will work on the later models. So, as you can see, the first one that started the range, the line of compatible processors was the 8086 or the 8088. They're basically the same processor on the inside. The only difference is the pins on the connections on the motherboard. Other than that, exactly the same. So here we see the instruction in assembly, and here we see the machine code which we would see in the memory. So we can scroll down to the move, because we had, as you can see, that stuff we will talk later. But this is the first instruction, the move. It's the move instruction. The L is a size indicator. It means the length is a long, which is 16 in this case. Is it 16? L is, 32 bits. A word is 16 and a byte is 8. We go to the move. Let's see, where's the move? Yeah, there, move. So we go to the move, and we can see what it does. It moves data from one location to another. Well, that's easy enough. So it moves it from one location to another. And if we scroll down, I'm sure we go to the 186, 188, blah, blah, extra instruction, 286, blah, 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 386. That's ours. And see if the move is here as well. If we have a...
Yes.
Yeah? Move. We can move to and from special registers. There's some extra moves, but we don't see the move long here in this list. But the move long, the L is only an indicator for the size of the data which we move. So we go back to the move, and we see the move has no machine code in this table, because it depends on what type of move it is. But for all the different types of moves, we will have a specific machine code instruction. That's interesting, huh? So what an assembler does is we can write moval, which is nice for us. We can understand it. I can understand move. Move is something, it's easier for me to understand move than 7A or whatever. I mean, easier. I'm not saying impossible, because I had a girlfriend once. I know it's hard to believe, but I had a girlfriend once, and she worked for not Lidl, but Aldi. And I don't know how it, I think they don't have that anymore, the system. But she had to know all the PLU codes of all the items in the store by heart. So she had to study in the, she had a little picture book of all the products, which were not that many back then, but milk, I don't know, sheep milk or whatever, because it's always cheap stuff, cheese, and whatever. And she had to know all the codes for it. And then when she was at the register, it's like tick, 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 tick. Not the barcode, but they have a special PLU code, which I call, it's like a 4-digit number or so, I think. And tick, tick, tick. And she knew the PLU code of every item in the store. It's to me, that's unimaginable. But she did, I mean, she was like, oh, peanut butter, 601. I don't know. Milk, is it full milk, half full milk? Full milk, oh, that's 7185. What the? I mean, really? But, some people really amaze me. And if you do a lot of programming, you would be the same. I mean, I'm amazed by how many things I know by heart when I'm working with it. And how do I know that? Well, because you do it all the time. And if you program a lot of assembly, you will quickly learn all these codes by heart. Because, if you use them all the time, it's not that many. I mean, look at the list. I mean, what happens here? Hop, Look at the list. It's not that many. I mean, and most of them you'll never use. I mean, the move is a very important one, the load effective address is a very important one, but I don't know. Here, GCXZXZ, is that an important one? I don't know. Out is quite important. Well, of course, these ones are quite important because they're, leave the stack frame, push. Well, there's a lot of stuff which you might never use. And the further you go down the list, especially if you go all the way down to the later, this is the new stuff. There's two types of instructions. You have the simple instructions, which are up here, like the move. If we go back here, remember, this is the basic schematic of every CPU. Every CPU that we have, this is the basic schematic. And all the instructions that we have are to manipulate data here. So what we can do is shift it, add them together, subtract them, invert them. I mean, how many different things can you do? I mean, it's not that many. If we scroll all the way down, we get the extensions. Where are they? Oh, still there? Here, no. Oh, that's nice stuff. Yeah, here. We get to the extensions, which are called SIMD instructions. And SIMD instructions are instructions which operate on a group of data instead of just one element. Because as you could see in the basic schematics, I have one or two numbers and they go in the ALU and something happens with the two numbers. This is what we call a single instruction multiple data. Now it's not two numbers, but we can have a whole range of numbers. And this means that your processor has a specific design. And these instructions are specifically for encoding videos, encryption, that kind of stuff. And we can see a whole lot of stuff happening here. Packed double word. A packed double word is a different name for an array. So we have an array of double words, and a word nowadays the word is 16 bytes typically. So a double word would mean 16 bytes. A word is 16 bits, so a double word would be 32 bits. And what we can see is a packed double word, so that means an array of 32 bits, integers. And we can do stuff with it, compare in this case. So these are the more complex instructions, and you probably recognize these words on processors. It has 3D now, or SSE, or SSE2, or SSE, and here we have Intel AES instruction. What is AES? Encryption. Yeah. So we see that some Intel processors have specific instructions for encryption. And that's very cool, because that makes encrypting things and decrypting things a lot faster and easier on your computer. And even some undocumented instructions, so they're not in the manual, but they do work. Of course, undocumented instructions are very dangerous to use, because they're not guaranteed to be there in other versions of the processor. So, okay, so in this case, we have the move instruction, and it moves this to there. So we see move is the instruction. L says something about the size. In this case, end M stands for end message. And it's a label. This is a text. And you will see that here as well. And all the stuff, well, so, that's better. So, I can point it out. This, with the dot in front of it, is just information for the assembler. So it's not information which is translated into code. This is just for the assembler to know that the start of the program is at this position. What position? This position, which we can find here. So this is where the program will start. Then we say, here we will assign our data. Why does it need to know that? Because in the in some operating systems, and in this one as well, and some architectures, it is possible to separate code and data in the memory. And remember, with virtual memory, we can say data can be read-write, but code is read-only, for example. And we can say code needs to be able to be executed, but data does not need to be executed. And we can flag it. So for security reasons. So this is to tell the compiler or the assembler that this is data. This is what we call a label. It's just a position in memory. Up until now, nothing. There's no machine code in memory. Nothing. This is all information for me translating this into machine code. Now we get some machine code. This is the first machine code, the H, because this says to the assembler that what will follow is ASCII. And what is ASCII?
Characters.
It's a translation. It's a representation for characters, because everything in the computer is nothing but bits, and so. Letters do not exist for a computer, but someone said, well, let's just give letters a number. So, for example, what's the number for the H? Does anyone know? Well, I know the capital A is 65, so 66, we can calculate it, huh? I don't know. Capital A is 65, and then we need to count to the capital H. Huh? So this is just numbers. And what it says here is that what I write here is ASCII coded. So it knows that it needs to translate the age into, I don't know, 70? Did someone do the math already? 73?
Yeah,
72. 72? 65, yeah.
So it's
72. 72. Okay. So this will be translated into 72. Of course, that will be written down in hexadecimal, so we have to calculate what it is in hexadecimal. But so this is just this. Every letter here will be one of those two hexadecimal numbers. Every one of these. That's it. Okay. So here we get actual code. Then we go here. This again, nothing. It's just a position in memory. This position in memory is the address, the memory address of the H. Because the H is the first byte in our program, in our memory map. And we said that we want to label this position. And the label of this position is this one. So it's the memory address of this H. This position is the memory address of the next byte in memory after this position. And that's not this one, because this is again, dot text says that this means that this is code, executable code. It doesn't actually do anything. So start and end message will point to exactly the same position in memory. Yeah? Because there's no code in between. So this location is the same location as it. And they both point to the number for move, because that's the next actual byte which we will find in memory. So what it says here is take this label here, that position in memory, and that we want the position of the memory, it's denoted with this dollar sign. So we take this memory location, that's the memory location of the move itself, the first byte of the move, and we put it in one of the registers. In this case, DX. DX is the register, and the E is for the size, extended DX. The DX is 16 bits. DX is 16 bit, extended 32 bit. So a 32 bit number of this memory address will be in ED. Then we say subtract sub. Huh? Sub. Sub means subtract. Subtract this number from the value there and put the result there. That's what subtract does. So what we do is, now what if we do that action, what's the result in EDX? What number will be there? We can say exactly which number will be in DX now.
Move L?
Sorry?
Move L?
Move L? No, I don't think so. 32. 72. Why 72?
Because that's the number of
A. But let's, we put this number that we put into DX, that is the memory location of what? Which byte? Started to, yeah, the H. Huh? So if we so we have in memory, let's say this is the RAM memory, huh? Usually we go from the bottom. So we say 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, well, okay, so on. Now we start somewhere. We don't know where, but let's say we start here in 3. And the first byte of our program is the H, then the E, L, L, O, space, world, backslash N. Let's see, do your 10, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17. So let's continue a bit. Hop. In this, if that's our program, then what is the value of end M? Label end M. Which one?
15.
15, you say. Let's see. Is he right? We all agree? I agree.
Yeah.
Because after the hello world, here is our moval, huh? And here is the the machine code for moval, huh? There's the machine code, whatever there is. And we said if we put the label here, it will take the memory address of the first byte after that in memory, which in our case is the move. So that's this number, 15. Now what we do is we subtract the message. What is message? 3. Because message is the memory address of the first byte when what appears after message, which is in our case the H. Yeah? Do you see that? Yeah? So what is the value of EDX? Yeah, makes sense. And so we get 15 and we subtract 3, and we have 12 in EDX. So if we look at our computer, this is our computer, this is our CPU. After the first two instruction, after the first instruction, we put in EDX, that's that one. It's only divided into, we can, as you can see, we can the data register, the D register, we can take it as a byte, or as a word, or as a long. Here we can take the first 8 bits, we can take the first 16 bits, or we can take the full 32 bits, depending on how many bits we need. And in our case, we used EDX, so the full 32 bits. And we said in the D register, in that memory space, first we put 15 there, and then we subtracted 3. So now in DX, in that register, we stored 12. Very good. And why do you think we put 12 there in our example? What do you think the 12 represents?
The amount of characters.
The amount of characters, yes. 12 is the length of the string. Hey, we have E H E L L O space W O R D L D exclamation mark. We missed that one. So that's the length of the bytes. And what we want to do is we want to tell, because I know where this is going, we want to print this on the screen. And can we print anything on the screen? We cannot. Because the screen is output. You don't want anyone to just print something on the screen. That has to be controlled by the kernel. It's I/O. So we have to ask the kernel to print this on the screen. And we do that using a
system call.
Yeah. So we're going to do a system call. And one of the things that the system call needs is how many things do you want to put on the screen? So that's the first variable which we put. And we put it in DX. Then the next one is we move a message into ECX. So now we put number, in this case, message was, what was message?
Three.
So let's we have DX, and DX was 12. And CX is now the 3, and we get the B, I think, and the A, huh? BX and AX. Oh, it's E, all E, huh? Extended. So, there we go. So now we set B, and B is set to?
One.
And A is set to?
Four.
And apparently that's for the system call. Let's have a look, and then we go to, in our case, because we use Linux, and to jump to, remember, how do we go to the kernel using a?
System call.
Yes, or in this case, what's this? Interrupt. And why an interrupt? Because when we do an interrupt, the processor automatically switches to kernel mode. That's the only way to switch back to kernel mode is to do an interrupt. Sometimes there is a specific other instruction which does the same thing as an interrupt, but it has a specific name. It's the same thing. Here we can just use the interrupt, and we say interrupt, in our case, 80 hexadecimal. And that interrupt jumps to Linux. And now Linux will look in the CPU, in the registers, what to do. And we can look at Linux at the system call. Let's see. Linux system call list. Honk. Let's see. Is this a nice one? Yeah, well, here they are. 0, sysexit, sysfork, sysread, syswrite. Hey, I recognize the number 4. See? And number 4, so in AX is the number of the system call. So these are all the system calls for Linux. See? And number 1 is exit. That's interesting. Let's have a look at our next part of the program. What happens here? What happens here? Yeah, we put 0 in B and 1 in A. And then we jump to Linux. And what system call do we execute there?
Setup and exit.
Yes.
0 is for setup and 1 is for exit.
Yeah, but A is the system call number. And this is the argument. So let's look at the argument. So we see that setup has no argument, but we say exit has one argument, the status, and that can be used. What does exit do? What does that system call do? It exits. Huh? It terminates the current process. Nice. See, this is how we exit. So we ask Linux, kill us. That's what we ask Linux to do. But it's, you should ask Linux to kill you if you're done. That's if you don't, then you don't know what happens. You have to tell Linux, hey, look, this is basically to tell Linux you're done. Yeah? So that's, and then Linux will kill your program. The status is something that Linux will report to the operating system or the calling process, so it's available. And if typically convention is that 0 means everything is fine, a negative number means there's a problem, a positive number is information of how it worked. For example, so in our case we use which number?
0.
Let's move to the right. Sys right. Ha. So, hey, this is interesting. I think we have our other registers, eh? B, C, and D. The first one is unsigned int fd. Does it say what it means? Then I think a file descriptor. Then the, oh yeah, it is the file descriptor. This is something you need to know. The file descriptor, that's a Linux thing. Every file in Linux has a number, and so if you open a file on the disk, it will get a number, maybe what, 8015, any number. And if you want to write something to the file, you say I want to write data to file number 8116 or whatever, if it's open. That's the file descriptor. But the first 4 file numbers, they are already, or first 2, 3, 0. The first file numbers are already filled in by the system. 0, if I'm correct, because I do this by heart and I'm not very good with these things. 0, I think, is standard in, so it's the keyboard. 1 is the standard out, which is the screen. 3 is standard error, which is the logging system, typically, or the screen. And you can redirect them as well. So the file descriptor which we use, in our case, was 1. Because 4 is the system call number, system write. Then this is the first argument, 1. Means we want to write it to the screen. If I want to write it to a file, I just need to put the number of the file there. Of course, how do I get the number of the file? I would have to open a file. I'm sure there's somewhere file open. So let's see. System no
no.
Sys open. Yeah, but read same thing. We need to open it first. Oh, here sys open. So see, sys open. It returns the number of the file. So if we call system call number 5 with the file name, see the flags and the mode, it will open the file and it will return, it will leave in one of the registers, it will leave the number of the file. And if we want to write to the file, then we use the same write, but then we instead of using number 1 here, we put the file number which we got from file open. If we want to close the you need to always close the file. We are working very, very, very low level here. No one is taking care of you here. If you make a mistake, it's a big thing. Huh? So you open a file, you write to the file, you close the file. If you don't close the file, big problem. You don't know what happens. But it could be serious, huh? Because maybe you even destroy your file system. If you work on a virtual machine, you destroy the file system of your virtual machine within the virtual machine. So you know, this is one of the reasons why we like working with virtual machines. Because if you screw up, but it's fun. It's really fun to play, and you see relatively how easy it is to do it. Even at the you cannot go any lower than this. This is the lowest level to program. Huh? And but I think there was even a nice. I've seen some system call reference. Oh, here, see, it's a nice list. System read, write, read, open. So you see, these are all the system calls you can do in Linux. 313 in total, and this is where they are in the source, because Linux is open source, so you can see exactly where they are programmed, where the actual code is of the system calls. Okay, cool. I thought that was a nice. Oh, yeah, Linux system call reference. We have to read again. Read from file descriptor. Yeah, that's the arguments. And you see exactly the whole description of how it works. So, nice. Okay. Let's go back to the presentation. Because you will play with this. And I hope you understand a little bit now how a little bit, because you're in the lab, you will play with it more and you will do it more. And this is programming. You just have to practice it. You just have to play with it. But that's what you can do with assembly log. All computer code, all, no matter what language you use, Java, Python, C++, whatever, at the lowest level, it's always this. I mean, like I said, you cannot go any lower than this. And there's two types if you program in Linux or assembly language in general, for the Intel 386 or for the Intel system. There's two different dialects of assembly programming. One is the AT&T and one is the Intel. And here you see exactly the same program, one in AT&T and one in Intel. And but if I'm not mistaken, because of course I was wise enough to put the no names with it, this is AT&T and this is Intel. As you can see here, the things are reversed. So this is moved there. This is moved there. This is moved there. You don't need any of the size denotations with it, with Intel. But other than that, same code. So if you in the lab, we will use both of them, so you can see how you can compile both programs. The Intel one, you program with a compiler, or an assembler. An assembler called NASM, NASM. And this one you can do with a GNU. The AT&T you can do with a GNU compiler, GCC, or ASM would work, which we use in the lab. Most if you and this is crucial, if you're looking for examples on the internet, they use either one of those. And it doesn't matter. But if your code is written in AT&T syntax, and you find an example on the internet in NASM, you will need to translate it to that. But you can see it's not that difficult. I mean, it's or you need to use the other compiler, the other assembler. Okay, the last few slides, and then I'll show you a few more things, and then we are done. The last few slides are on the applications. Applications do not always directly call system calls. This is the kernel, and the kernel, we can access the kernel through system calls. Remember, we can do that, but there's a lot of libraries written for the system, which make the system calls a lot more intelligent. For example, if we look at the system calls, it's interesting. If we look at the list of system calls that we had, let me see if there's. I think this is a nice one, if I remember correctly. Yeah, there, this is nice. See, so. That these system calls are extremely low level and basic. So if we want to do basic stuff, it's still a lot of work. If we want to do networking with system calls, if we want to do printing with system calls, if we want to do Windows programming with system calls, that is a lot of work. So thankfully, others have already created what we call libraries, which is code that creates a shell over the system calls. For example, if you go to Windows in Windows and you go to print something or open a file, you will always get the same dialog box. That dialog box is not a system call. These are system also for Windows. This is the type of system calls that you can do at the lowest level. For Windows, similar thing. I mean, we have Linux, but Windows similar. But there are libraries on top of these, thank God, that implement a lot of stuff extra. So typically, as an application programmer, I don't directly call system calls, but I use libraries. I use network libraries. There are network libraries. For example, I can open a socket. Well, that's nice, because I don't think that that's a system call. I don't think. I don't know. Of course, now I want to know. Is there a socket? Can we go? Oh, of course, we can search. Well, socket. Ah, no way. Socket call. And what does socket call do? Is that the only? There's only two. Socket call or socket. It's the only socket call. Sys socket call. Now we can look it up in our other list that we had. Which number was it? Socket. 5. Socket. Yeah, socket. 103. 103. Okay. 103, where's 103? Hey. Oh, this only goes to 30. That's nice. 103. Go now, but this doesn't show what we do. Where was it? here. Yeah, this one. And now we go to 103 socket. Socket, oh, there we have it. What does this one do? Socket system calls. It's a common kernel entry point for the socket system calls. Call determines which socket functions to invoke. Pooh. Except byte. Ooh, they look familiar, huh? Yeah, so there is a socket system call. But there is networking API built on top of this to do all sorts of nice stuff for us already. So that we don't have to implement everything ourselves. There's libraries. And these, we typically call these libraries which are on top of it. Of course, I can always call the underlying system calls myself. But then I would have to do a lot more work myself. In Windows, this is for Windows, for example, the Windows 32-bit API. And we see as well, there's a lot of libraries available for a Windows application. And if we want to do a system call, we would have to call the kernel directly. But we don't do that. We have all sorts of APIs, higher level libraries, which we used, and they use system calls within them. Okay. Well, the last thing which I would like to show you is that, why not? Let's have a quick look. The simulation, some of you already have seen it. This is a small simulator we use in one of our our classes in system network engineering, and this you can forget. I mean, this is only interesting for if you want a low level. This is the microcode within the CPU, but here we see a computer program, and this computer program that calculates 1 times 2 times 3 times 4 times 5. What is it? Faculteit in Dutch? I don't know what it is in English. No clue. Factorial, I think. The exclamation mark thing. And the factorial thing. The factorial of 5. That's what it calculates. So here it starts with 7C, FF, 7-8, FE, 6E, what the hey? Huh? If I'm not mistaken, I'm gonna see if I can find, let me quickly see if I can find the lab that goes with it. If I'm not mistaken, that's system engineering. Quickly go there. And that's CPU, logic, micro programming. Yeah. So here I have the lab, which we use in the other class. And as you can see, let's see, it has, oh, no, it's not the right one. Let me get it here. It's the next one, probably. This one? No? Here. Yeah, this one. So here we see these are the, on that simulator, this is the instruction set that is simulated on there. So we see here we also have a move. We have a move R1 comma X moves the value X into register 1, and the machine code is 70. So let's do some programming. Let's where's our little here's our little thingy. Let me move it here, then I have it. So I'm going to wipe the RAM. Can I clear it? Reset. Oh, nice. So we set 70. Oh, not 70, 70 binary. So 70. 70 was move. a number into R1. What number? Well, we probably should put that also in memory, otherwise it doesn't know what number to load. So let's say we want to put 5 in there. 5. So we have 70 was the instruction to move a number into R1, register 1, which is this one. So what we expect to see now is that it will move that 5 to register 1. Let's have a look. I press cycle. You don't need to be too bothered about this. This shows exactly all the steps that are taken by the processor to actually do it. But all we need to do is wait until it's done, which is now. And as we can see, the 5 has been moved to register 1. Holy cow, this is amazing, huh? What other instructions do we have? We have, for example, the next one is nice. Move a value stored at the RAM address, memory address A, into register R1, and that's 30. Let's try that one. So here we have 30, huh? So now we do 30. Zero. And now it's not the number, but the memory location of where the number is stored. So let's put our 5, well, let's say we want to load AA. So we're going to put AA here in A. So AA. And we want to move that AA into register 1. And here we don't put AA, but we put the memory location of where the AA is stored. What is the memory location?
0A.
So, and if we press cycle now, we see the magic happen. It should at least. Wow. So far nothing. Yeah. And the crowd goes wild, huh? Unbelievable. Now, there is two ways of storing and receiving, retrieving data from the processor. We can do that directly into any memory location, as we saw here. For example, we can maybe store it into memory. Let's see, I don't know. I mean, even though I created it, I don't know all the instructions by heart. But maybe we can move it back. Is it? Yeah. BC moves it back. So BC, let's say we want to move the AA. We want to copy the AA in memory to the next location. It was BC, huh? So BC. Oh, I want too many. BC. And now we want to copy the AA to the next location, to 0B. So what do we put then there in location 5? 0B. B is this one. 0B. So what it will do now is it will move whatever's in here to that location. And to make sure that we have a different, let's make this into AB. Huh? So now you will see that the AB will be stored here. Cycle. Nice. Huh? Nice. So, okay. Well, the last thing, and then I'll let you fly away to Arjen, and you can play yourself with assembly programming, is the stack. The stack is a specific piece of the stack is very important. And what we can do is push something on the stack or pop something from the stack. And it's done by the it's done using the stack pointer. Let's see. Push is A0 and pop is B0. Okay, that's simple enough. So the stack is typically at the end of the memory. So in our case, let's say this is the end of the memory, 1F. So we put, it uses stack pointer, and in the stack pointer we will put 1F. And I think AB was push, huh? If I'm not mistaken. No. A0. I can see it here. A0. Yeah. A0. It's just one instruction. A0. Because it doesn't need any variables. It's just, or any operands. It's just A0 means whatever is in R1, put it on the stack. So let's see. We're going to do that instruction cycle. Boom. There. See? And it automatically decreased the stack pointer to 1E. See? So now the next piece of data will automatically be stored here. This is like your little notebook that the computer uses to store data. It's called the stack. The stack is nothing special. The stack is a piece of memory where we can automatically drop some data on it and take it off. Let's do it again. Let's change this into BB. BB. Brigitte Bardot. Huh? And now we do again the same thing. BC. Or 0B, I mean. No, A0. Huh? A0. So, shoot. A0. So, because we can see with the instruction pointer of the PC program counter, we can see the next instruction to be executed is in memory location 7. So, here, this one. So, the A0 is the next one to be executed, and what it will do is it will put again the BB onto the stack. Let's see. Ooh, exciting, huh? Unbelievable. And now with B0, we can take it from the stack. So let's do B0. B0, it will now take it from the stack and put it there. So let's zero this one out. So we can see that it's changing. And cycle. And now it should take this one, and it would decrease the stack pointer, because it's now 1D, and the stack pointer should go back to 1E. So let's see. Hey, it didn't work? It didn't work, huh? Oh, I know why it didn't work. We put it in the wrong. We put it here, but this is where it was supposed to stay. So we are now here for some reason. Apparently, we did a jump or something. Let's try again. Did you see that I put the instruction in the wrong place in memory? Huh? But now it says the program counter is set to 0A. Apparently we jumped in for some reason, because we executed the instruction 0000. I don't know what they did, but let's hope it will still work. The stack pointer is 1D here. This is the free space on the stack. And what we expect to happen now with the instruction B0, where is it? B0? This one, because that's where it is. We expect this number to move to the register, and we expect the stack pointer to move to this number, because now this number will become free, huh? This location on the stack. Etsy, but it might be scrambled now because I don't know what the 000 instruction did. And it worked, huh? So we see that it did work. The stack pointer is now 1E, so this is now the free space again. Register now is BB, the number that's here. So it took the number from the stack. And the stack, as you can see, is something you can put numbers on there, and you can take numbers from it. That's the stack. It's nothing more, nothing less. But we use it, and you can read that in the book as well. It is used to store data, temporary data, during calls. And one of the most common attacks in buffer overflows involves messing with the stack. Because a lot of very interesting data is stored on the stack. And if I can access the stack, I can access a lot of data. But that's in the book, that's chapter 10, paragraph 1. It's written how the stack is, but you need to play with it yourself a bit. We will have a lab with the stack as well to see what happens, yeah? Okay, I hope this helped a little bit to get some information on assembly programming. And then I wish you a lot of fun with Arjen and the labs. So he's probably still in F104 if you want to go. And I will put more information on the exact schedule from now on VLO, because we need to make a new schedule for the two tracks. Yeah? Well, have fun. Thank you. So, stop it.